The Eighth Doctor and Big Finish has been a run that I think is really difficult for the uninitiated to get into, because you basically have these really lengthy eras of the show. You've got the Charlie Pollard run from the very beginning, from like 2001, where him and a brand new companion have all these adventures. Then you get the Lucy Miller ones, which came out in like 2005, 2006, to try and capitalize on the revival of Doctor Who. And then in around 2010, 2011, Paul McGann has a rebranding of the Doctor, where he gets his leather jacket, and then that leads into Dark Eyes, which is a quadrilogy. And then you go into the Doom Coalition, which is another quadrilogy. Then you go into Time War stuff, which has like another quadrilogy in and of itself. Ravenous is a quadrilogy. And then you go into Stranded, which is another quadrilogy, which culminated earlier this year in Stranded Volume 4. Now, the Big Finish team, knowing that this is an impenetrable and massive amount of Eighth Doctor content to get into, have decided to inform people that this brand new Eighth Doctor set, starting with What Lies Inside this month and next month, we've got Connections with the Eighth Doctor. We've also got companions, Liv and Helen, played by Nicola Walker and Hattie Morahan, respectively. These are companions who the Eighth Doctor has already been pre-established, but these adventures are meant to be a new jumping on point for people who are trying to get into the Big Finish Eighth Doctor range, which is why this is where I'm hopping on, because I love the Eighth Doctor, but I do not want to listen to a quadrilogy of quadrilogies in order to get fully caught up on what's happening inside of that Scouse noggin of his. Thankfully, though, this box set called What Lies Inside has some terrific stories in them. We've got Paradox of the Daleks by John Dorney, which is a two-parter, and we've got The Dalby Spook by Lauren Mooney and Stuart Pringle. That's a one-part story. So we've got 3 hours of Doctor Who with the Eighth Doctor, a two-parter and a one-parter. Let's start with Paradox of the Daleks. So, where to begin with Paradox of the Daleks, which has instantly jumped up my list as one of the best Big Finish stories that I've heard in 2022. Like, top five instantly. Maybe top three. But Paradox of the Daleks by John Dorney has the Eighth Doctor with Liv and Helen land on a spaceship where the Daleks have invaded and they are trying to run some temporal experiments. Now, the space station that they're on is run by a crew that have only just started dabbling with time travel technology. Like, very fundamental, very rudimental time travel technology. But it's sophisticated enough that the Daleks apparently want to set up a bridgehead there in order for them to get the jump on a potential enemy for a war that they are fighting on many fronts. I hope you're kind of understanding the implications here. And it's very difficult to talk about Paradox of the Daleks in its totality without diving into spoilers. And I'm going to try and avoid spoilers as best I can for Paradox of the Daleks. But basically, the paradox of the title is not just about the Daleks trying to get a head start on a conflict, a time war, so to speak, that they're trying to get a head start on that in light of overwhelming opposition from their unknown and unnamed enemy in this story. But it's also the friends that we made along the way, where bootstrap paradoxes beget bootstrap paradoxes, and the Doctor, Liv, and Helen are right in the middle of it, trying to subtly push events into the right direction without knowing that that's what they're meant to be doing, to try and fight off this brand new race of Daleks. Now, I say brand new race of Daleks because the Eighth Doctor has not properly encountered this design, this bronze, mostly riveted design. He's had some run-ins in the past before with them, but he still hasn't quite figured out what their deal is. So, let's play a quick clip from Paradox of the Daleks.
A staging post for an army?
Yes. A sort of hidden entry point. A surprise. They say they're from some war in the future. Or sort of the future. I'm not entirely sure. They weren't clear. It sounded almost extra-dimensional.
That would explain a lot. They do look slightly different from the ones I'm used to.
What do the ones you're used to look like?
Fewer rivets, for a start. Less bronze. And they don't have that splash of paint on the back the two subordinates have. I have encountered this type before, well, bar the paint bit, but I've never really been able to identify their origins.
Right. And that's important?
Well, and the circumstances probably not. Carry on.
They said their enemies were incredibly powerful. They needed to get the jump on them.
So they're trying to launch a preemptive strike, using an out-of-the-way time portal operated by an obscure species to attack their opponents before the war even starts. How paradoxical of them. And potentially extremely dangerous. That sort of corruption of cause and effect. It could spiral out and destroy the universe. Are you glad you started those experiments now?
Not really, no.
Even the Daleks wouldn't usually be so insane as to do this. This enemy of theirs must be very dangerous indeed. They didn't by any chance mention who they were, did they?
No.
So not Cybermen or Santarans? Not the Eminents? Have the Porcians finally gone into their groove?
They didn't mention any names at all.
Pity. Someone who's making the Daleks that scared might be worth helping out. Either that, or there's someone to run away from in abject terror. Horses for courses.
Like I said, it's very difficult to talk about Paradox of the Daleks without properly diving into spoilers, so I'll try and, you know, beat around the bush as best I can. But Paradox of the Daleks takes some really wonderful elements that we've seen from Terry Nation's Dalek stories back in the 60s, including, but not limited to, the Khalid mutant inside being emptied out in order for other people to pilot them, the Dalek mutants themselves being quite, you know, a powerful threat while out of their casings. We also have a really wonderful, like, supporting cast as well in this story, because it's a very complex story on paper. I think that John Dorney's script is so tightly knit and so well put together that it's actually astonishingly easy to follow. It's just very difficult to explain. But we've got Petum and Jamash, played by Joseph Milson and Amy Roxon, respectively. And they are the people who are involved in this time-space experiment. Jamash was who you heard in that clip just there, talking with the Eighth Doctor. As the Eighth Doctor, Liv and Helen have landed on this ship, and they... basically, they land on this ship. They're told by the Daleks that two crew members have already been killed and that there's only so many people left on the ship. How did you get here? And the Doctor's like, oh, I'm a new person. I'm a new recruit, and now has to try and save face with Jamash to try and make sure that the cover is not blown. They are really properly trying to infiltrate the Dalek ranks here, and it's so much fun because Petum especially has no idea what's going on with the amount of paradoxes and the complicated timey-wimey nature of the plot, and Jamash as well just sort of has to roll along with it. She's doing well, but it's like, oh, we're trying to dabble with time travel experiments, but we clearly had no idea what we were getting ourselves in for, because this is clearly the type of story that comes from messing around with time and time travel and paradoxes. There are multiple paradoxes of the Daleks in this story, but it's so playful, it's so fun, with a real sense of, like, of stakes, while still being incredibly entertaining to listen to. I think that this is the best ever implementation of whoever smelt it, dealt it, as in that line, that rhyme, is put to such astonishing effect that it blew my mind that John Dorney did such a great job with it. It's honestly defies description to just talk about as matter-of-factly. What I will say, though, is that this is a great box set generally, but it's also a good story for Liv and Helen, because I have not listened to any story with these two companions. Like, none at all. I know that Liv has been around for a long time in Big Finish. I think she started off in a Seventh Doctor set and then branched out to become an Eighth Doctor companion. And Helen Sinclair, I think she joined around Dark Eyes time. She's kind of been joining the Eighth Doctor for the quadrilogy of quadrilogies. So, you know, these are well-established companions in Big Finish, but I didn't feel alienated listening to them. I felt like they were such a great counter to the Eighth Doctor. Somebody who, you know, they're both very smart. I think one of them is, like, I think they're both scientists of, like, different professions, but they're smart enough to keep up whilst being very good audience surrogates. And they also don't put up with the Eighth Doctor's shit. Like, when he's being all timey-wimey and obtuse and confusing, they're really good at just, like, holding him down and being like, can you please explain what's going on? There's also a moment, a revelation, where they discover something seemingly at the same time as the audience, and they basically go, I think we've just figured this all out at the same time. So clever. And I think John Dorney has done such an incredible job making a script that's complicated, that's full of time paradoxes and loops and self-fulfilling prophecy and things like that, making it so easy to follow, but still so entertaining. A fun Dalek adventure with real stakes and peril, some great moments of horror. We get some Easter eggs and some laying of the groundwork for the Time War, but maybe or maybe not, it's able to play a little bit fast and loose with that. We do know that there's going to be another Big Finish box set later on with the Eighth Doctor, Connections, which is going to be have a Weeping Angel story in it. Whether or not this is going to be dealing with any fallout from the Time War, I don't know, but I'm really looking forward to finding out. But this is not the only Eighth Doctor set on this collection. We also have The Dalby Spook by Lauren Mooney and Stuart Pringle. Now, the Dalby Spook is not as good as Paradox of the Daleks, and that sounds harsh to say, but it's only because Paradox of the Daleks is so freaking good. But the Dalby Spook is a very different type of story. It takes place in the 1930s in the Isle of Man, where the Doctor, Helen, and Liv encounter Harry Price. Now, Harry Price was a real-life investigator, paranormal investigator, who specialized in the debunking of the what goes like bump in the night and going to these places and these supposedly haunted establishments and these haunted houses with the express intent of trying to debunk the mystery. And one of the mysteries that Harry Price did write about was about Jeff the Mongoose. Now, Jeff the Mongoose was a very real in quotes, supernatural event that happened with a family in the Isle of Man. If you Google The Dalby Spook, which is the title of the story, you will be able to find the misadventures of Jeff the Mongoose, which was this paranormal entity that was haunting this family, supposedly in the 1930s. And the Doctor, Liv, and Helen go to this house with Harry Price with the intent of discovering just what is going on. Let's play a clip from The Dalby Spook.
And they're here for Jeff, not that ratty old sheepdog.
Oh, don't make such a fuss, Pa. Jeff says they're not even from the newspaper.
He said what?
Fury! Don't you dare be so rude! Fetch that tea!
I'll come with
No! You. I'll not have guests making tea. Fury. I won't ask you again.
You've scared him off!
Now! She has her mother's temper, I'm afraid.
I heard something.
Me too.
Yes, what was that exactly?
Oh, that was him, all right. A bit of your phenomena.
Fascinating.
Ah!
Is that...
Shh! Vary!
That's not her. Listen.
He's in the wainscot.
It's coming from the kitchen.
No, it's moving. Listen.
Jeff's on the prowl.
What is it, Doctor?
I'm not sure.
Mice in the wall cavities. Rats, even.
Yeah, who are you calling a rat?
What was that?
I'll handle this if you don't mind.
Who's there?
Miss Chenka! Listen! I demand to know!
The chair! Oh. It moved!
I saw it!
The chair you had your hand on, Mr. Irving. If you think...
That
voice again.
So, obviously, Jeff the Mongoose is not a particularly scary voice. He's played by Harry Myers. But it's a very good and affecting paranormal story. And one reason I really, really liked it is because it doesn't forget the element of paranormal stories that often does get forgotten in adaptations or in supernatural fiction. And that is the family at the core of it. You've got Jim Irving and his daughter, Vori Irving. Now, Vori has got an imaginary friend called Jeff, who is the paranormal entity in this house. But what Liv and Helen seem to observe is that, you know, Jim is a bit of a neglectful father, somebody who is not there for his daughter, and the daughter has maybe conjured conjured up this supernatural imaginary friend so that she doesn't feel lonely. And while I don't know anything about Liv and Helen's backstory or their past or whatever, Helen in particular finds it very difficult to be in the house and to be around the Eighth Doctor, who is kind of missing the human element, because the Doctor is interested in trying to find out what's so alien about Jeff and what's happening with Jeff. And Helen is like, you know, I was born in the year that this story takes place, 1933, and I grew up in a household where I was ignored and I was neglected, and I'd want to make sure that the daughter here is looked after and is safe. And that was really a really admirable direction for the story to go in. And you often like get stories like, even in the Conjuring films, which I love as fun, like fun house spooky stories, do kind of forget the family relationship that's often at the heart of them. I think the in the Conjuring films, the partnership between the Warrens is done really, really well. But often the family trauma and the family drama and everything, the conflict that's taking place within the household where the spooky stuff is at, often gets thrown to the wayside. But I really appreciated that it was really focused in on, and that the Eighth Doctor, over the course of this story, does seem to be making the wrong decisions. And part of that is because he clashes very fiercely with Harry Price. In almost any other story, I think that Harry Price would be perceived as the hero or maybe a pseudo companion of the Doctor, but when paired up with the romanticist, like Byron inspired Eighth Doctor of like classic fiction, who sees the romantic side and sees the, you know, who would often name drop, who would often in his stories name drop like Monet and Dostoevsky and things like that, you know, a very cultured Doctor who sees the poetry in everyday life, including the supernatural events like Jeff and the rattling in the walls and stuff, and sees people like Harry Price who want to debunk all this stuff, taking all of the life and the fun out of the universe, and he clashes with him. And I think that's really interesting. So you get this really genuinely motivated conflict between Harry Price and the Doctor, which exacerbates his relationship with his companions Liv and Helen, because they're centering on the family at the heart of the story, the Irving family, who just so happen to be haunted by a mongoose called Jeff. And the fact that it's able to pull off this sort of like, you know, the fact that it's able to pull off these consecutive narrative, like bam, 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 bams, like these layers working all the way down from the concept to the character execution, is quite a marvel. I actually thought that Lauren Mooney and Stuart Pringle did a terrific job at being able to balance all of these elements and still make it cascading. Thank you, Lily, in the chat. Cascading elements that complement each other as you go further down the layers of them. I thought it was really deftly handled. And obviously, Paradox of the Daleks is a really hard act to follow, but don't sleep on the Dalby spook. Like, you know, if you go onto the cover, you know, the Daleks with the Gallifreyan symbol and the cracking of time and everything, you know, that's the seller. You know, that's the cover image and everything. That's the game-changing two-part story that's fun and paradoxical. But the Dalby spook is, you know, is also like a top tier big finish Eighth Doctor adventure with really smart implementation of the companions, great sound design across the entire box set. And I think it was Benji Clifford, you know, formerly of the Five Who fans, who did the sound design for both of these stories. He's done like top notch work for this box set. Incredible sound design, great music. The disc for Paradox of the Daleks has got 10 minutes of brand new music that was composed for it. The behind-the-scenes interviews are really illuminating and really fun. This is a terrific box set. What Lies Inside is a very generic title, but you should not skip this box set. Honestly, if you are somebody who has been yearning for more Eighth Doctor in your ear holes because, you know, you've found things like Stranded and Doom Coalition a little bit impenetrable to try and get into mid-story, this is the hopping on time. This is the long-delayed arrival for the Eighth Doctor arriving into Big Finish once again for these brand new sets. What Lies Inside is terrific, like one of my favourite box sets of the year. And I really am looking forward to what happens next for Connections, because we once again have the Eighth Doctor, Liv and Helen. We've got a Weeping Angel story, Here Lies Drax by John Dorney, the Love Vampires by James Kettle, and Albie's Angels by Roy Gill. which is a Weeping Angel story in London. This is a standalone box set, as far as I can tell. Like, the Derby Spook doesn't end with a cliffhanger ending that goes into Here Lies Drax for the next set. So you can be rest assured that you can go into this box set with no prerequisite and have a really good time. The Eighth Doctor, What Lies Inside, one of my favourite sets of the year so far, and Paradox of the Daleks is just top-tier Doctor Who. I loved everything about it.